journey starts in Bouse, Arizona, right here at the old assay office, now turned museum, and I think the Chamber of Commerce for this interesting spot in Arizona. But it's currently closed because I'm here pretty early. But you can see this building was built about 1902, well before Arizona was even a state. Right here in the vicinity of Bouse was Camp Bouse, where they actually trained the people that drove the tanks in World War II. So this was an area that has historical significance to that time. And if you're into that sort of thing, we're gonna look at something really cool, so stick around for that. But you guys know my jam. It's old wood and stuff like this. Old wooden relics and miners' shacks from the past, with a corrugated tin roof, rotting wood, preserved by the hot Arizona sun. This is what I like. You can see this is an original miner shack. It came to Bouse from the Swansea mine, which is one of our prime destinations today. So that actually makes this much more cooler and unexpected. I'm gonna have to get my other camera with the zoom lens out here now to get some of this cool stuff that's in here. Old pictures, it looks like. And the smell that you guys know I love, that dusty wood out in the desert, old antique smell. A little bit of mildew, a lot of like aged by the sun. I don't think this makes any sense, but. And here's like an ore crusher from back in the day. Looks like it was used in like 1946 to 48. So all mining equipment around here of varying ages, and even like rails for ore carts. That stuff is always so cool to me. Oh, I'm glad I saw this. I was walking back to my truck, and this is basically saying that back in the day, Bouse had several hotels and a boarding house, and the foundation that we see here, didn't even think about that. Right there was a two-story hotel, the Alaska Hotel, and the front doors faced the corner of Main Street and Santa Fe Avenue. So I'm gonna guess here, you see how it's like turned this a ways. This probably was the front door right here, where you would enter the hotel and be like, hey, I'm glad I'm here to check in. Whoever took the time to do this though really put a lot of like thought and effort. It's a beautiful, beautiful display, especially this miner's cabin. We have a full day of exploration ahead of us, so it's time to get back to Slim, and we're gonna head to one more stop here on our way out of Bouse so we can really dig into the history of Arizona ghost towns. And here we are standing at Route 72 through Arizona. If you've traveled between Lake Havasu City and Phoenix, you've probably come through here before, and you've probably remarked at the tank. But we're giving you a deeper look at this if you haven't already done so for yourself. Anyway, the thing that I really wanted to see is the tank. Like right over this way, and there's a couple other military vehicles, it looks like, also. Basically, this camp was established by Patton in World War II to have, I think, about 5,000 folks that volunteered to be in the Army, specialized soldiers used to test out this new thing they called the gizmo, which was like a light defense system that the tanks would apparently launch, probably something really bright to like dazzle and confuse the enemies and illuminate areas. So that was secret technology of the war being tested out here. Probably a top secret thing at the time. That's cool.
And a little, I guess, a miss, probably a bomb, I'm gonna guess, of some sort. Maybe some kind of early primitive missile, or maybe it's just a made up artifact. I'm not sure if that's based on a real weapon.
Digging, it looks like it's a target rocket is what that's called. But you can actually see, looks like they have pictures of tanks. I don't think tanks here, these were taken in Belgium, but probably people that piloted these tanks. There's a guy here, Frank Pettinato, on 8-Ball the Mule. There's something about 8-Ball the Mule over there that I didn't read carefully, but
I wish I'm spending more time here. This is really cool.
And there's like memorial plaque after memorial plaque. As far as the eye can see, you might need an hour to read all that. All right, well, here's the official word of 8-Ball the donkey. Apparently 8-Ball was a drinking buddy at Camp Bouse, so. All right, the day is moving on quickly and we've got some remote areas to get out to. Still a bit of driving to do to get there, so I need to cut it short here in Bouse, but let me know what I'm missing, especially when it comes to old mining history, old buildings, old West history. What around here did I miss so I can plan a trip back? Okay, we are now on our way to dig in deep to the older history, the older mining history of Arizona as we make our way out to Swansea. Just need to plot my route and make sure I know where I'm going. Starting to get a little wiser driving around places like this. Trying to, you know, starting to order paper maps and backups because a lot of modern technology gets a little bit wacko when you get out into these areas. I'm actually using a combination of Google Maps and another app that I'm trying on a trial basis called, I think it's OnX Offroad. Not sure if it's like, if that's how you pronounce it. It's spelled like on and then X. I don't know if X is set as an X or something else. Extreme is what it stands for. No. I would be curious to know, like for some of you that do this, like what's your preferred software that you use? Like assuming you use some kind of GPS like OnX or Gaia perhaps, something like that. I have All Trails for hiking and I didn't really know if All Trails, I haven't even tried it out, is it really viable for off-roading? I'm not sure. I don't think it is, but let me know. Yeah, it gets sandier and sandier, but in like little bits, just where any of the waters flowed out through the desert. Out from the desert, I should say, and some... Oh, okay. Hold up there, big boy. We gotta slow down. There are some pretty big holes there, but I avoided them all. This is fun. Looks like I've got 8 miles until we hit like a hard turn. It says a right turn on Swansea Road, but I think I'm on Swansea Road. But here we go. Here's some good look at the sand terrain. And here's where you could really get a tire stuck, I would say. Whoa! Oh! It's like I don't want to slow down because that's how I'm afraid I'm going to get stuck. But is that the proper strategy with that? You know, I'm trying to not let my wheels spin because I think that's just bad etiquette from what I see. You don't want to tear up the road for the next person coming through here. But I'd like to study on the proper techniques in situations like that. Because honest to God, I was thinking like today was gonna be a piece of cake, and it's not bad, but I wasn't expecting as much sandy conditions as I'm seeing so far. And yeah, I'm definitely a noob at the off-roading and learning as I go, but I'm here doing it, so that's what's important. So if I sound like overly cautious and like, geez guy, it's because yeah, I'm a noob and I'm okay to admit that. Okay, so, quick summary. I came from Bouse and drove from that direction. You could probably just use Google Maps and plot it and like start in Bouse. It probably will show you exactly what I did. I've had Google Maps running this whole time. I've let it, made sure I haven't disconnected it because I do not have connectivity right now. Well, now I just got a little bit, but you're probably not gonna be able to rely on that unless you prepare in advance. So but anyway, so far, yeah, Google Maps will get you there, it would appear. Ooh, we drove by a steep grade sign and we're getting closer. I think we're only a couple miles away now, but it's really hilly back here. Really interesting, like formations, small mountains, and a steep grade warning. So the off-roading is now getting more adventurous, so that's why I wanted to share. But I don't think this is like clench worthy, but it's I would say on the trip so far, this is the most exciting part of the road. Although I wouldn't say one would be titillated by it. But I love the different like colors back here. There's a lot of like rusty red starting to show up, and dark brown, like chocolate brown rocks. And a narrow bridge. Ooh, like a narrow one-lane bridge. I would not want to be out here during like a monsoon storm. That thing has potential to be wiped out one day. If that ever happened, I guess you probably couldn't get back here unless there's a back way. Which I think there might be. When it sets, it takes about an hour or longer to drive from Bouse out here. It's true. It's taken me a little bit longer than that because I've been stopping a lot, but I do think I see our first sign that we're approaching Swansea proper, getting closer, because I see tailings, first of all, and based on videos, I know what's out that way, and I actually see restrooms. They actually do have vault toilets out all the way out here. For those of you in need. So we didn't have to drive far to get down to some of the remnants of La Paz County here. Remnants of Swansea, Arizona. This is probably like a building that had multiple offices, it looks like. This is Clara Consolidated offices, circa 1909. So that's really cool. And then if we come over this way, that sign indicated that this part of the building is a mess hall, circa 1912. So a mess and recreation hall. Makes sense, because if the miners' quarters were out back there, they had to have something to do out here. I mean, if you didn't notice, even in modern times, the landscape would look probably almost identical to what people over 100 years ago would experience out here. So being that this is the mess hall, I'm gonna surmise there were stairs there one time, and you know, there was probably a trail that went to the miners' cabins, but probably tables and stuff over here, I can imagine, and I surmise that that is an old stove of some sort. And I think another YouTuber's video I saw, they surmised the same thing. That would only make sense. So that could be the same like grill top or whatever they had, wood-fired burning like thing that they used to cook. It's always a treat when you still see the remnants of like the stucco or whatever this the proper name is for that. Like the outer veneer, if you will. And you can actually see a glimpse right through that hole of the innards of the wall, which is really just a conglomeration, like almost like a cement. But yeah, I don't wanna contribute to like erosion of this, so I shouldn't do that. Anyway, but yeah, you could literally probably pick this thing apart with your hands, like if you had a few hours. I mean, it's that brittle and that, you know, I think this is just something for the our generations, you know? This isn't gonna be here forever. No way. That's an aspect of my hobby of coming out to film. One of the things that's the most satisfying for me is this thought that maybe there's a small chance that hundreds of years from now, maybe even 50 years from now, when this melts away into just a concrete foundation and no more brick, that I've created something for the future to document like the current state of it. So, and then someone in the future will be here to make a video, and maybe they'll find my videos on the internet somewhere long after I'm dead and gone. But so there's an aspect of that to this hobby that I love. And that's where the addiction to coming out to these places comes from for me, I think, is that I'm standing here on a very warm, hot October, what is today's date even? October the 14th on a Friday. And so far out, away from everything and people, if I just stand still, I just hear the occasional song of a bird or the buzz of a fly. And there's cool artifacts all over the ground, like old rusted out cans. There's a truck over here and a mine shaft.
This might be hard to capture on film, but I think this is designed to walk on top of. I hope so, because I'm gonna do it. And you can see others have had the idea to try to fit a rock down in there, I'd say. We'll do a practice run on this side. It's a little dicey, actually, because this stuff bends under my feet. So this is a bottomless pit. One that I can't judge the depth on. And even though I'm sure I could walk across this thing, there's no way in hell I'm gonna do that. No way. Not today. I wouldn't be surprised if this was bat friendly, and that's why they have like the openings on the sides here, because bats like to roost in these places, so it might be that. And you see yet another pit, and yet another one. And I even think I see a portal, or a couple, like mines over that ways that might have bars in front of them, but we'll go take a peek. Very cool. So here's a mine I think we could peek in. Let's just be careful of our surroundings though, a little bit here. There's a grate up high too, but I don't know what's in there. Probably a shaft that goes straight down, but it looks like somebody may have tried to fill some stuff in here, maybe. So not too much interesting to see, but here's a couple more for you. One over here, and then one up over there. They dug like hundreds of feet down, I heard, and oh, what do you know? There's yet another one. That one looks like it might be more exposed. Maybe not. Yeah, I don't see how for like public safety reasons, whoever put this here, I understand now, I mean. But actually, when you look in there though, they're really not like deep straight pits down. They don't appear to be. It's like they tunneled down and then probably started tunneling off to the side, but still very dangerous. And just look at the piles of rusted out barrels and what appear to be coffee cans. I bet you like the coffee cans and stuff are from the era. I wouldn't be surprised. You really can see though where this landscape has been ripped to shreds, you know, from the mining activity and more tailings there. They probably dumped the contents they were mining out of here up there, but I think I see some timbering in there. Hey, look at that. So yeah, if you went down there, I guess it just opens up, or there are tunnels going underneath, I bet. I don't know how far down, but I did read some of the tunnels are hundreds of feet here. Probably the deep one we saw in the beginning that went straight down. You always see like really interesting rocks if you keep an eye out like in places like this. This one's very green. I don't know if that's indicative of copper. I found it right here on the ground. And I'm gonna leave it here. This is federal land, so I'm not rock hounding, but I am interested in the concept of rock hounding. But anyway, I don't know what's like worth keeping and what's not. So this is probably garbage, I'm sure. Now if we explore the remnants of buildings, this foundation is where the old assay office once sat here on this property. So I guess things continued well after 1912 then, or whatever date I was reading back there, because this would have been the ASARCO, I don't know what that stands for, general offices around 1929. And this one does look a lot nicer. Almost 100 years old though. All right, I think I've held off long enough. I've been itching to go inside and check out these miners' barracks. Probably the best preserved part of this whole experience that I've seen so far, and likely that is the case. And here you go, these are worker cottages. These are a little bit later too, still over 100 years old. 1917 is when these were primarily in use, it sounds like. There are signs saying don't destroy your American heritage, and you know, we're all about that, and be careful around wood and stuff. But there's actually beds left over in here. We'll go in some of these for sure, but this is already exceeding my expectations. I didn't think we'd see like actual leftovers of furniture and stuff. That's kind of rare.
I assume this is the original plan and they replicated what it used to be like. If so, that's cool. I like the way they have that entryway there. And then you could see there's just like, you know, hey, get up, go to work and turn, make a left and you're in the office. This is creepy though. I feel like somebody's watching me. This is a small room, and I wouldn't be surprised if you were bunking with at least one other person, you know, probably a bed on each side. I mean, these were blue collar, hard working folk, you know? So that wasn't uncommon, even in earlier times, to share a tent with a complete stranger. One thing that's not too shabby, though, is the view. Looking out the window there. I'm telling you what, man, there's like noises, like squeaks and weird phenomenon, I'm telling you. Starting to freak myself out a little. And I swear, I almost feel like I hear the faint sound of a donkey, like a hoofed creature, and then this like squeak sound. Wouldn't, I mean, that's not inconceivable, but here we go. Here's actually a good specimen. I think they left some of the original floorboards here and they had boards going across, so they would have nailed down the boards, I suppose. And wow, there's a lot of freaking graffiti. John over there really made his mark. 1991. And this guy, my gosh, it's gonna take down the whole dang wall. I would say out of all the rooms I found so far, and unfortunately they're not numbered, I'm not keeping count, this one's my favorite. Just because of the way the wall's exposed here. It's kind of got a cool pattern to it. And to boot, you got the window with the brick exposed. And a lot of the floor is still in here, so giving you that glimpse of how the rooms were laid out. Like every layer you really get to see here. One interesting fact that I haven't shared yet is, where did this town get its name, Swansea? Why did they call it that? So that was an interesting note up on that initial sign. It's named after the town in England where they were shipping all the ore, Swansea, England. So they decided to name it after the ultimate destination for what they were mining here. That was a pretty cool thing. I hadn't known that until I read that on the sign. When I hear the words over 100 years ago, to me, it just signifies in my brain automatically that it's a disconnected time now. There are no people left to tell the tales from that time. Although that's not true, because people do live well into their hundreds, but most of us don't. And it's a connection now with nobody here to tell the story on this earth about this building and the fun times and the bad times that occurred here behind these walls. All of the human drama that probably occurred, people that got along, people that didn't get along, suspicious people, people that loved each other, hated each other, were rivals. Maybe there was the one that every day was a hell for them to go get up at work and they had butterflies in their stomach as they had to go face their coworkers. In all of that, the human side of these places, it would have existed here. And you can see we're on the other side now of the miners' cottages or barracks. And over here you've got signs indicating this is an archaeological site. And there's excavation, I guess, happening around here. But people put findings up here of like period stuff. Like, that is cool. Some kind of pottery or something. And lots of rusty nails, like ceramic pieces. That's neat. My goal is a building out that ways, where I want to try to get over that way. And I'm not sure if I have to drive up this way or around this way. There's quite a lot of stuff to see, man. I underestimated the size and the scope of this place. Shame on me. The concrete structure there was a hoist house, so they would have had, I don't know, a head frame or something, some powered pulley system that was probably mining out of this. And I actually see like a lot of supports and beams, maybe, or concrete even,
where they reinforced that shaft. And no, I don't feel like walking out on this because this is really like flimsy feeling to me. But that one seems like a bottomless pit. I think this probably would be a very, very deep shaft.
I'm gonna come up with my own little nickname for this town here, and I'm gonna dub it the Rhyolite of Arizona. It just gives me the same kind of vibe that Rhyolite has, like if you've ever been out to the Death Valley area, Beatty, Nevada. So yeah, Arizona is Rhyolite.
Oh boy, they're talking about the shafts around here. The one that's fenced off is like 1,000 feet deep. The one right over there. That is deep. That is deep. There are a couple level sections that look like maybe grading and some support walls, but that could just be where housing used to be. I don't know. Because I read there's a train depot, you know, I don't really see many other options other than it being this, or maybe a foundation of something that I missed, which is very likely out here.
My only main word of advice is don't underestimate how much there is to do and see at this place, because I certainly did. But whatever this is over here, this looks like a centerpiece to me. It's beautiful.
There are signs that are all over here, so we'll learn. Look at the brickwork. Beautiful construction. I love the color, it's like peach. This one was good enough to fence in, but I could see why. This is really, really awesome. Now we will learn what this is. Dun 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 dun. What was it? Oh, it's not what I thought. The shop dust chamber.
It's basically a processing facility, I think, that worked with the smelting process. So no train depot. So either I missed that one or we still haven't found it. Or I was making the whole thing up, which is possible.
And you have to admit, this is a super impressive structure for the time period when it was built, as well as being out here in this really remote location. I mean, those bricks didn't make themselves.
Well, folks, there you have it. Our first adventure to Swansea, Arizona. We did not see everything by a long shot. There's much on the horizon left to be seen, but I thought we did a very worthy first exploration, and that trip out from Bouse up here to Boot wasn't too shabby. I hope you had as fun as I did, and I'll see you next time.